Good morning, everyone. Today we will be having our lecture number 18 in MA303 heat transfer, and this is going to be the last lecture on heat conduction chapter. So we've been talking about unsteady heat conduction, and in unsteady heat conduction we said that we'll proceed in three steps. The first one was a lumped capacitance analysis. The second one was where the spatial effects were important, where the temperature was a function of x and t. And the third one is where one of these spatial dimensions will be very large, that is tending to infinity. So this discussion in this lecture 18 is going to be on the semi-infinite analysis. Okay, so semi-infinite is, again, as I said, that you have one of the spatial dimensions tends to infinity. So this we'll call x the spatial dimension, and this of course is the surface. So this is my x equals 0. So x goes from 0 all the way to very large value till infinity. So x tends to infinity on the right hand side boundary or the lower boundary. All right, so in this discussion, the question will be, is it realistic? Do we actually encounter situations where semi-infinite analysis is important? And the answer is yes. An example is the surface of Earth. So if you have the surface of Earth, which for example for the whole night has been for the whole day it's being heated because of the sun and so on. So let's say the whole Earth's surface is at the same temperature, and then suddenly the sun sets. So at a very high altitude region or at places close to the poles, you have very low temperatures. So as the radiative heat flux is gone, so the temperature drops very, very rapidly. So what happens is that the surface temperature, or the temperature outside the surface of the Earth in the atmosphere, suddenly drops. So it's like a situation where you have provided a step change. So the complete surface was at a temperature which was, let's say, T equals T initial, and then suddenly you make the surface temperature as TS, which could be very cold. And then you have to see how the temperature drops inside the Earth's surface. Below the surface embed a pipeline, I'll have to figure out what depth it should be so that the water does not freeze in this pipeline. So to see how the surface temperature affects, slowly penetrate inside the surface of the soil of the Earth. Okay, so we again, a temperature in this case will be a function of x and t, but the only difference is that one of the x dimensions goes all the way to infinity. Okay, so of course, I mean, realistically, you won't have infinite length that you will be analyzing, but there are situations, for example, when this semi-infinite analysis can be applied to a situation where the spatial effects and transient effects are important. Now, if you remember in the previous lecture, we talked about the infinite series solution of this bar. So we said that we have this rectangular bar, which is of course symmetric, and we have some convection boundary condition on both sides. So in this bar, we said that the series solution that we have, we wrote the temperature as a function of x and t as a sum over n, where we had something, some coefficient dependent on n, which was a function of time. And then we have some cosine of some function of x. So we had some things here. So in this case, we said that if our Fourier number, so we said that if my Fourier number, which was a non-dimensional time, was less than 0.2, so in that case, I could approximate this whole thing as only the first term in the series. But that is that cannot be done in a situation where my Fourier number is, if my Fourier number was greater than 0.2, In that case, I could approximate this as only the first term, because we had some exponential term e to the power of minus something times square. So what we said was, as time proceeds, the amplitude of this wave, subsequent waves, goes down very quickly. So only the first term is significantly contributing to the overall temperature. But the Fourier number is less than 0.2, then the approximation with the first term is not good enough. So we'll have to have lots of terms in the series to approximate the solution. But then again, that becomes cumbersome, because you have to add lots of terms to approximate this. But what we can do is, in this situation, we can apply the semi-infinite analysis for this bar. So what we can say is, for this bar, if you're talking about small Fourier numbers, approximately less than 0.2, then what that means is that if you make a step change, let's take a slightly different boundary condition where you have the surface temperature specified. So what that means is that if you suddenly change the surface temperature, it will take some time for that effect to percolate or penetrate into the bar. So if you're talking about very small times, like just a couple of instants after you change the surface temperature, it's as if the bar is infinite in this direction. Okay? Because as compared to the time you're talking about, the spatial dimension, this is my L. So L is, I'll tell you why this is the case. But even this L seems very long enough, because the temperature has not got enough time to percolate or penetrate into the bar. Okay. So for these situations, we have, for Fourier numbers less than 0.2, instead of adding all those terms in the infinite series solution, we can approximate that with a semi-infinite solution. Okay. So that is exactly what we'll be discussing today. Okay, so let's start with the equation. Let me just sun here. Sorry for that. There was a lot of haze on my writing tablet. Okay, so today, let's first write the system of equations we're talking about and the boundary conditions, as we always do, and then we'll try to solve it mathematically, and then we'll analyze the solution to see what information we can extract and what ideas we can learn from that for this analysis. So we will use our Earth example. So this is my x equal to 0, and this is where my x increases all the way to a very long distance, tending to infinity. So in this case, the equation is exactly the same as what we had for the spatial dependence. We have the transient term, and this is equal to my alpha, the diffusivity, times the spatial conduction term. Okay, so this is the equation, same as last time. The only thing that has changed is the boundary condition. So the initial condition is again the same. The temperature at all the points at t equal to 0 is, I'll call it Ti. So the whole soil or the earth is at Ti, the initial temperature. My first boundary condition is the top boundary. We'll say that talk about the other boundary, which is temperature at x tends to infinity. So it's so at a very long distance, whatever you do on the surface here, that does not matter, because that information will never be able to reach at x tends to infinity. Okay, so that means that temperature at x tends to infinity will always be the same as ti, because we started with t equals ti, and since we're talking about a very long distance, so whatever you do on the surface at x equal to zero, that information will never be able to reach at x tending to infinity. So that's the boundary condition we have. And then the boundary condition 2, which is for x equal to 0, well, we can have different kinds of boundary condition. Again, we can have a Dirichlet, a Neumann, or a Robin boundary condition. So Dirichlet is when you specify the surface temperature. Neumann is when you specify the when the top surface is insulated, so there's adiabatic, so there's no heat flow. So that means del T by del X is 0. Or it could be Robin, where you specify the heat flux. That is, you have a convective boundary condition on the top. Okay, so for this discussion, we'll use the Dirichlet boundary condition. That is, temperature at x equal to 0 is, we'll call it the surface temperature TS. So we'll assume that in this case, your surface is, it suddenly become very cold. So we'll say that suddenly the temperature dropped all the way to minus 20 degrees centigrade. So TS is the constant temperature, which in this case we are assuming is minus 20 degree centigrade. Okay, so let's try to solve this system with the given boundary conditions. So you can see that we will not be able to use the same ideas as last time, because one of the boundary conditions has changed. So the complete problem is including the boundary condition. So in these kind of, whenever we want to analytically solve partial differential equations, what we do is we try to convert this system of P, this PDE to an ODE, that's an ordinary differential equation. So we try to do some sort of transformation where either we split this into two ODEs or we convert this single PDE into a single ODE. And that is what we'll do, the latter. So in this kind of a system, what we see is if we make the transformation that we introduce a new variable, that is eta, as x okay, so we introduce a new variable that is eta, which is defined as the fraction x divided by 2 square root alpha t. Now we will discuss why we are, what is the physical significance of this, but mathematically what we see is that if we make the substitution initial and boundary conditions, what we see is that temperature becomes only a function of eta. So the dependence on temperature, dependence of temperature on time and position x, can be clubbed into just the dependence on eta. Okay, so this kind of variable eta is called a similarity variable. Now some of you may remember this from your fluid mechanics, where when you were solving your boundary layer equations, you use the same idea. But if you don't, that's all right. So we use this idea of similarity variable in this kind of an equation, mathematical system. And let's do that. So let's substitute x and t in terms of eta and then see what we get. So first, let's try to write our del temperature by del x. So when I want to write this in terms of eta, which is a function of x and t, so I can write this as, using my chain rule, this becomes del t by del eta and del eta by del x. So del eta by del x, since we have defined eta as x upon 2 square root alpha t, so this becomes in this case, we see that temperature is only a function of eta. So to start with, I will write it as dt by d eta, because I will later know, but still, since I already know that, I'll do that. So I write dt by d eta, that means t is only a function of eta. And then we have, so this becomes dt by d eta, and then d eta by dx is 1 upon 2 square root alpha t. Okay, then remember we want to find this del 2t by del x2. That is what I'm trying to find. So then I will take, I'll write my del 2t by, that's very light, this color. Well, this is thickness. We'll go back to our thick pen. So my del 2t by del x2 is del by del x of del t by del x, which is nothing but del by del, well, d by d eta of del t by del x, and then we have del eta by del x. Again, the chain rule that we applied. So sorry, and this will be that's okay. And then my del eta by del x is going to be the same as what I had earlier, which is 1 by 2 square root alpha. So this becomes, I have this is. This can be taken out of the differential. What we get is d2t by d eta square, and then we have 1 divided by 4 times alpha t. So this is my del 2t by del x2, and that is what I wanted to find. To substitute that back into the equation. And the next thing I need is del temperature by del time. Okay, so this let's go back and see what we had. So now this is my eta dependence on time. So again, I can use the chain rule. So I can write this as dt by d eta, and then I have a del eta by del time. All right. This this can be written as dt by d eta. That stays as it is. And when I do a del eta by del t, so my eta is x upon 2 square root alpha, and then we have t to the power of minus half, so we get a minus half, and then we have a t to the power of minus 3 by 2, that is a t root t. So I can write it more nicely. You can write it as minus half, and then I can take my x by 2 square root alpha, and then I can take a square root t and call it eta back. Again, this becomes eta. And then we have a 1 by t separately. So I'll call this 2 and I'll call this 1. So let's go back and have a look at the equation again. So this we'll call, this equation we'll call A. So now I would want to substitute 1 and 2 into A. So on the left hand side, I had del temperature by del time, which I'll replace with this expression. It's minus half eta. On the right hand side, we had alpha times the second partial derivative of temperature with x. So this becomes 1 by 4 alpha t. And then we have d2 temperature by d eta 2. Okay, so we have a couple of terms that get cancelled here. So we alpha gets cancelled, then we have the t on both sides, and then this 2 gives us a 2 here. So what we have is finally a minus eta dt by d eta, and that's half of d2t by d eta squared. Okay, so you can see that everything boils down to this equation. So I'll write this as d2t by d eta squared on the left hand side. On the right hand side, I'll keep a minus 2 eta times dt by d eta. Okay, so this is my equation. And you can see that in this equation, we don't have any t or x. So our assumption of temperature only being a function of eta was correct. And that is the reason I had simply started writing d temperature by d eta, rather partial temperature by partial eta. Okay, so we can see that t is only a function of eta in this case. So this gives us an ODE, but we also have to check the boundary conditions to be sure that there's no x or t occurring in the system. So let's check the initial condition first. So the initial condition was earlier. So the initial condition said that the temperature at time equal to zero is Ti. And if I put time equal to zero, and what I get is eta equal to infinity here. Okay. So my initial condition becomes a condition for eta tending to infinity. So this tells me that at eta tending to infinity, that is at t equal to zero, I have my temperature equals Ti. Then we have the first boundary condition, which was at x tending to infinity. So when x tends to infinity, my eta tends to infinity as well. So checking again, so here as my x tends to infinity, my eta tends to infinity as well. And that is the same condition as earlier. But what we see is that the boundary conditions are such that when x tends to infinity, my t is tending to Ti. Okay, so this is, I don't have to add any other condition here. My new system, there's nothing like a time or x. We only have one variable. So this condition, this new BC for eta, it satisfies both my earlier initial condition and the first boundary condition. So I'll call it BC1 now. and our new BC2, which was for x tending to infinity, sorry, which was at x tending to 0, or x equal to 0. So when x is 0, my eta is also 0. Okay, so this is eta equal to 0. And that was, my temperature was TS. I was using a Dirichlet condition on the surface. Okay, so this is our complete system now. And what we see is that there is no x or t separately. All we have is eta. So this is our ODE that we can solve for the temperature now. Okay, so we have successfully turned our partial differential equation to an ordinary differential equation by using this similarity variable eta, which is x divided by 2 square root alpha t. So let's quickly solve this. It's not very difficult to solve this equation. So what I'll do is I will call my dt by d eta as p, which is a function of eta. So if I substitute that in my equation, so let's call this A1, this is 2, and this is 3. So if I substitute this equal to P, then what I get is this, and that can easily be integrated. So I can write my t as okay. So we can write this as ln p equals minus 2 eta square. Well, you don't need the 2 anymore. And then I can take the exponential on both sides. So this becomes p equals e to the power of minus eta square plus c1. So that becomes e to the power of c1 times. So I will, let's call this c. So this becomes e to the power of c times e to the power of minus eta square. And I'll call this e to the power of c as some other constant. So this is c1. Okay, so this is my intermediate expression for p, which was nothing but dt by d eta. So I can integrate this further. So this becomes so dt is c1 times e to the power of minus eta square d eta, and then this time I will use limits. So I'll call this let's call this eta tilde. Okay. I just want to call it a different variable. So I'll say that eta tilde goes from 0 to some eta. So when my eta tilde is 0, my temperature is T0, and then when my eta tilde is eta, my temperature is T eta. I already have included one boundary condition here. And well, so let's write this. So this becomes temperature at eta minus temperature at 0, and this is C1 times integral from eta tilde going from 0 to eta e to the power of minus eta tilde square this one. And we already know this. So if I check my BC1, sorry, BC2, So this is telling us that at theta equals 0, we have temperature equals TS. So I can substitute that, and I can call this TS. In fact, I can write that on the right hand side. Seems that the application has crashed, so we have to start it again. Sorry for that. So this is my expression for theta, but I still have one constant C1, so I have to apply, I have to use BC1, which was at eta tending to infinity. So what I do is, and I know that at eta tending to infinity, my temperature is Ti. This becomes Ti is eta tilde going from 0 to infinity. Then I have e to the power of minus eta tilde square d eta plus ds. So this quantity, e to the power of minus, so this integral, e to the power of minus x square dx, you may remember this from statistics. So this is the normal distribution, e to the power of minus x square, well, the functional form. And this integral from 0 to infinity is actually an irrational, which is square root pi, this is 2 by square root pi, check, sorry, a square root pi by 2. This is, if I was to plot this function, so e to the power of minus x square looks something like this. It looks like a mountain. The same normal distribution that you've seen. So at x equal to 0, this is my e to the power of minus x square, sorry, huh? Not the integral. So this is my function. So at x equal to 0, this is 1. And as x tends to infinity or minus infinity on both sides, it tends to 0. So this is my function e to the minus x squared. So if I integrate this from 0 to infinity, which is half of this, this is square root pi by 2. If I take the complete from minus infinity to plus infinity, I get a square root pi. So this already is well known. So we are using that idea. So what we see is that Ti becomes C1 into square root pi by 2 plus Ds. So this now gives us the value of C1 as 2 upon square root pi into Ti minus Ds. So if I substitute this value of C1 into my expression, into this expression, I will get my temperature as a function of eta. Just checking. Okay, so this is our expression for T eta. In fact, we can write this in a slightly more interesting form. So T minus Ts divided by Ti minus Ts, the same way we used to write theta upon theta I. So this Ti minus Ts is the maximum temperature difference we can have. and T minus TS is the current temperature difference, and this is equal to 2 upon square root pi times the integral So we have successfully found the temperature as a function of eta in the form of this integral of the normal distribution. In fact, this whole thing is called the error function. It has a name. We call it the ERF, E-R-F, which is the error function of eta. So this 2 upon square root pi times integral 0 to eta e to the power of minus eta tilde squared d eta tilde is error function of eta. Okay. This is a very, very, very common function. It's so common that it's given a name because it appears extremely commonly in statistics. Let's have a quick discussion again. So we just plotted our e to the power of, we said this mountain-like graph that we had was e to the power of minus eta tilde square. And this is my eta tilde equals zero. And I told you that the area under this is equal to square root pi by 2. Okay. So what we do is we normalize this. So what I'm trying to say is that since we know that e to the power of minus eta tilde square d eta tilde from 0 to infinity is square root pi by 2. So we normalize this by multiplying both sides by 2 by square root pi. So this becomes a 1. So we define this function. So using this, we define a function. We define the error function of eta as 2 upon square root pi integral 0 to eta this. Should revert to the black color, it's much more clear. So this is how we define, and then if I was to plot this error function, the ERF of eta, so what you will see is that, this is my e to the power of minus eta tilde square, and this is my ERF of eta. So this ERF or error function starts from a zero, because it's an integral going from zero. So it's the integral from some value of eta, from eta equal to zero all the way to eta tilde equal to zero to eta tilde equal to eta. So what we see is that this starts from zero and then it approaches one because we have normalized it. So it approaches one. And on the negative side, if I was to plot it from eta equal to zero to eta equals, we don't need that. So let's keep this in the positive side only. Let's not discuss for the negative side. Okay, so this is my error function of eta. And I can see that my error function at infinity tends to, let's write it equal to 1. Okay. Now that we have an expression for my temperature, so the next step we will do is to calculate the heat flux. So in this case of Earth, the semi-infinite Earth that we have, there's heat flowing out because we said that our surface temperature suddenly goes down. And so in this case, my TS is less than my initial temperature. So what happens is the heat starts flowing out. So we'll call it the QS double primes. So that's a heat flux. Okay. So the watts per meter square. So we have to calculate this now. So let's quickly write our expression for temperature, because we will need that. So that is the expression we obtained, where the similarity variable eta was defined as x upon 2 square root alpha t. Okay. So now we have to calculate QS double prime. Now, as we know from the Fourier's law of heat conduction, then this is given as minus K times grad T. Now, since we're talking about only one spatial dimension, so this becomes del T by del X. So this is the flux. So minus K del T by del X. And then this is at X equal to zero. Again, since our solution is in terms of eta, so we can write this in terms of eta. So we can use the chain rule. So this becomes dT by d eta times del eta by del x. And I think we already derived the expression for dT by d eta. So if I quickly go back, we derived, so while deriving our solution, we already obtained as an intermediate step the value for P in this case. Sorry. Okay, so this, if you look here, then we said P, which was dT by d eta, was C1 times e to the power of minus eta squared. And C1 later was obtained as 2 upon root pi times Ti minus Ts. So we'll use the same expression now here. So that's 2 upon root pi Ti minus Ts. So that was our C1. And then e to the power of minus eta square. That was dT by d eta. And then del eta by del x can be obtained as 1 upon 2 square root alpha t. Okay. So this can now be simplified. And remember, this is all at x equal to 0. So in terms of eta, this becomes at eta equal to zero. Okay, so this two gets canceled with this two. Okay, so e to the power of minus eta square for eta equal to zero becomes one. Okay. So this is my expression for QS double prime. So well, in heat transfer, all we need is the temperature distribution as a function of the independent variables, in this case x and t, and the watts of or the amount of heat that's flowing in or out of the system. So we have successfully found that out. So our job is done for this case. So now let's, since we have the solution now, let's analyze that and get some feel for what's happening in this situation. So if I was to plot the solution, So reference points are so my initial temperature, as we know, is higher. So we have Ti, and then we have Ts as the surface temperature, which is lower than the initial temperature. So if we go back and look at the error function plot, so error function starts with a zero value and then approaches one. So what we see here is, let's look at the temperature solution. So what it is saying is that at eta equal to zero, this value is zero, which means that my T is equal to Ts. And that makes sense, right? So, in this case, if error function of eta is zero, then T becomes equals Ts, right? And as my solution, as my time proceeds, at eta equals zero, so as eta tends towards infinity, then the error function value becomes one. So what that would mean is that my temperature approaches a value of T equal to Ti. Okay, so in this case, let's write our eta was x upon 2 square root alpha T. So if I was seeing the dependence as a function of x, so if I plot x on my x-axis, then what happens is the temperature at x equal to zero, that means eta equal to zero, is Ts. So this is for any given value of T, let's say some T. So the temperature is, if I vertically am going down, so what I see is a zero temperature. Sorry, what I see is T equal to Ts. And then as my eta increases, or as X increases, that means eta increases, then my temperature has an error function kind of a variation asymptotic towards Ti. Something like this. Well, I would actually draw, let's say, a much more steeper here. Okay, so this is let's say this is for a very small value of T, and as my time proceeds, then what will happen is it's like the cold temperature is penetrating into the depth. Because if I leave it for a long time, what I'll see is that if I was tracking one point, then the temperature at this point will decrease with time, if I give it more time. So what that means is that the low temperature profile is somehow penetrating inside. So if I give it more time, then I will start seeing the temperatures So the temperature profiles will become flatter and flatter as we go further in time. So this is my increase in time. So as my time increases, I see that my profiles get flatter and flatter. So if I see the green profile here, so if I, that means that the temperature at a given value of X is going from the blue profile to the red one and then to the green one. So temperature's decreasing at a given X, and then at a given time, what we'll see is that as we proceed further to the right, as X increases, well, in this, when I say right, I mean the graph, but that means the depth. So as we go deeper and deeper into the earth, we see that the temperature's getting closer and closer to Ti. Okay, so Ti was the initial temperature. Yeah, so this is that's how we understand the solution, and this is obtained from the solution that was theta upon theta I equals error function of eta. So let's note a couple of things. So as my time increases, my temperature approaches TS. So let's go back and have a look at it. So if you look at the solution, what you see is that as my time increases, that is an increasing time will ultimately mean that my eta is decreasing. Okay, so as my time increases or eta decreases, what I see is that my right hand side here, error function of eta becomes smaller and smaller. And that would mean that T equals TS. And again, that intuitively makes sense, because if you leave this for an extremely long time, what you'll see is that this profile will ultimately be such that most of the Earth is at the temperature which was TS applied at the boundary, because there's nothing heating it. So heat is constantly getting lost from the top, and that will ultimately result in the temperature decreasing and reaching TS, because once the temperature of the whole system reaches TS, then there is no heat. And remember, heat flow is proportional to the gradient of temperature, and that we will see now. So let's look at the temperature gradients. So the temperature gradients, the temperature gradient decreases as time increases. So as my time is increasing, as we go from this blue profile all the way to the green profile, what we are seeing is that my temperature profile as a function of x is getting flatter and flatter. That means my del T by del x is getting smaller. So that means my QS double prime is getting smaller with increase in time. And we can see that because we already derived the expression for QS double prime. So from this expression, I can see as a function of as my time increases, my QS double prime decreases. So this means we can in fact we see that QS decreases as one upon square root t. So increasing time will result in a decrease in QS double prime. Okay, so that means that initially, when the whole Earth was at Ti, at the high temperature, and suddenly you change the surface temperature, then initially you had the maximum rate of heat flow, and with time, the rate at which energy is leaving the watts is decreasing as time increases. And one of the most important things in semi-infinite analysis is a quantity called the thermal penetration depth. So we denote this as the symbol delta with the subscript P. Okay, so this delta P is an extremely important quantity, because what you see is that as your time is increasing, the low temperature is penetrating into the surface of the Earth. So remember, initially we said that if I was to install a pipeline that is having some water flowing through it, I would want to know how deep should I penetrate this pipe? How deep should I dig the earth and install the pipeline so that by the time it's morning again and there's sunny again, the water does not freeze in the pipeline? What that means is I would want to know how fast does the cold temperature penetrate into the earth. So we define a quantity called penetration depth. So it's defined as the depth at which 90% of the surface effects, in this case, it's the low temperature on the surface, have penetrated. So it is that depth at which the temperature has reached 90% of the temperature that was there at the surface. Oh, sorry, 10% of the temperature that was at the surface. Of course, I mean, 100% will never happen. It will take infinite depth for that because you have an asymptote. But it is that depth at which you define, at which only 10% of the temperature effects are left. So what that means is my T minus TS upon so you know that this is this is 0.9. So this approaches one because you know that this was the error function of eta, and eta as your depth is increasing, your eta is also increasing. So this approaches one as eta approaches or x approaches infinity. So we're talking about that depth at which this difference, the ratio of the difference is T minus TS upon TI minus TS is 90%. Okay. So if I find the x value 9, that gives me the delta P or the penetration depth corresponding to that time. So this is a function of so this is a function of time. Okay, so if I was to find, so we have charts available to find the value of error function of eta for different values of eta. So if I look at those charts, what I'll see is that corresponding to the situation, my eta is 1.16. So only for a value of 1.16, my error function of eta becomes 0.9. Because error function of eta starts from 0 and goes to 1. So for eta equals to 1.16, my error of eta is 0.9. And eta, if you remember, was x upon 2 square root alpha t. So this equal to 1.16 is what we are interested in to find the penetration depth. So this means my penetration depth, which is this x value, is twice of this times alpha t. So this is 2.32. Times square root alpha t. Okay, so if I look at my delta P behavior, what I see is as my time increases, my penetration depth also increases. Okay, that makes sense because if you wait for a longer time, the cold temperature profile will penetrate deeper and deeper. And that is exactly what's happening here. So as my time is increasing, my delta P is also increasing. And if I look at the dependence on alpha, what I also see is that, well, for a constant value of time, as my alpha increases, my delta P increases. So what that means is if I choose a material for which the thermal diffusivity is high, the things diffuse very quickly, things that means that, well the heat temperature diffuses very quickly, what that means is that my penetration depth will be higher. Again, it makes sense because if you have a material which is highly conductive, diffusivity depends on conduction. If it's highly conductive, the temperatures going to the penetration depth will be much higher for as compared to as a material which is less conductive or insulating. So coming back to our example of that slab that we talked about. Remember in the beginning of this lecture, we said that if we have a slab of size 2L, and we're talking about a situation where my Fourier number, that is my non-dimensional time, semi-infinite analysis can be quite helpful. Because if I went for the earlier approach of adding the infinite series, it becomes very cumbersome because I have to add lots of terms, because the first term is not a good approximation to the overall sum. But what I said was that if you go for the semi-infinite analysis, you can use that quite effectively for this case. And that is exactly, so we just talked about the penetration depth. So if my Fourier, if my penetration depth, so what I say is that we can apply the semi-infinite analysis. If the penetration depth is less than L, so if you make a change, a certain decrease in temperature of the surface as TS, and then you allow the temperature profile to seep in slowly from right to left, so if only 90% of the effect of the boundary has seeped in toward the center, you can apply the semi-infinite analysis. If your delta P, the penetration depth, is less than L, if it's not crossed your L, then you can safely apply the semi-infinite analysis. And if I will not do it for you, but if you, we already know what the delta P value is, and we already know what the expression for the Fourier number is, if you do the necessary calculation, you will see that this will result in a condition where the Fourier number is approximately less than 0.2. So that condition of Fourier number less than 0.2 for the semi-infinite analysis to be valid for the rectangular power is coming from this delta P less than L. Okay, so we will stop here, and I will ask you to attempt the solved example in book. Okay, so this is the solved example number 5.7. So in this example, you are expected to use the semi-infinite analysis for solving the problem. So I'll just read the problem for you and explain it to you. So it says, on a hot and sunny day, the concrete deck surrounding a swimming pool is at a temperature of 55 degree centigrade. So the concrete around the swimming pool can be quite hot on a summer day. And a swimmer walks across the dry deck to the pool. The soles of the swimmer's dry feet are characterized by an LSF of 3 millimeter thickness of skin slash fat. Okay, so the sole of the feet, the foot has, let's say, I want to draw it. This is some layer of fat. So we are calling this equal to, this is LSF, which is approximately 3 millimeters. You have a 3 millimeter, that person has a 3 millimeter of fat. And the thermal conductivity of the sole of the foot is also given. It's 0.3 watts per meter Kelvin. It's not very conductive. So now they say that consider two types of concrete decking. A dense stone mix and a lightweight aggregate characterized by density, specific and thermal conductivity of given values. So the density and specific heat of the skin slash fat layer may be approximated to those of liquid water. You can approximate that, the density of your skin or fat to be the same as water's density. And the initial temperature of the skin or the fat layer is 37 degrees centigrade. So before you start walking on the deck of the pool, your skin and fat is at 37 degrees centigrade. Now the question is, what is the temperature of the bottom of the swimmer's feet after an elapsed time of 1 second? If the swimmer starts walking towards the swimming pool, that is the swimmer's stepping let's say standing on the floor, which is at 55 degrees centigrade, what will happen is that heat will flow from the deck to the swimmer's feet, and then it will heat it up. So you would want to know what is the temperature of the bottom of the swimmer's feet after an elapsed time of 1 second. So what you can do is, the first thing is, can we apply, so the body of interest, the solid body of interest is the foot, not the deck. The deck is at 55 degrees centigrade, it's huge, so it's not going to change the temperature of the deck. So the foot is getting the foot is getting heated up, and you would want to know the temperature of the foot at different depths. So the first thing is, can we apply the semi-infinite analysis for this case? And remember, they have asked you at t equal to 1 second. So what you do is, first you calculate the corresponding Fourier number, and you see that if the Fourier number is less than 0.2, then you can apply the semi-infinite analysis. And if you can apply the analysis, then you can find the temperature at different, or the penetration depth and temperature at different depths in the feet. So I'll not go any further here. It's a solved example. You can look at the answer once you have solved it. So if you have any questions, then you can always email me or write in the comments below the YouTube video. So I'll be sharing a tutorial sheet with you. So the second tutorial is due. So I'll be sharing a tutorial sheet where we'll have problems from unsteady as well as 2D heat conduction as well as unsteady heat conduction. So this brings us to the end of the topic of heat conduction and heat transfer. And the next topic we'll start from tomorrow is going to be heat convection. So the second mode of heat transfer, in fact, the most important, or the most, well, I shouldn't say most important, but the major mode of heat transfer in energy systems is heat convection. So we'll be talking about heat convection, its principles, and its analysis for engineering problems starting from the next lecture. Thank you.